very dignified garden, that for sure. How are you? Thank you.
zoning board meeting for the city of Brunswick, October 14th, 2014.
Roll call.
Larry Barber?
Yes.
Kevin Jones? Jesse R. I. David Henry?
Here.
Joe Patney? Carly Newbauer?
Yes.
Jesse R. I.
Yes.
Kaplan?
Yes.
Linda Hunter?
Yes.
And Mary?
Yes. Public announcement of the public media.
Please hereby note the pharmacy open for the meeting and provide with satisfaction annually decision of the time, place, and conduct of all the meetings of planning board of the city of Brunswick by the city clerk, taking appropriate number of lots of city hall, 78 Fire Street, must be noted as a gentleman in the city of Brunswick, and only to be in the borough.
Please stand by the floor. Appointment of a substitute board chair.
Larry Barber?
Yes.
David Henry?
Yes.
Joe Patney?
Yes.
Carly Newbauer?
Yes.
Jesse R. I.
Yes.
Kaplan?
Yes.
Linda Hunter?
Yes. Minister of Board of 2014.
Members of the board, you can tell me that they can run the minutes in their packet. There are several motions to make, or motions to approve, you know.
All in favor?
Aye.
Close. Yes.
All business, construction management associate 2013-25, site plan and variance application for construction of residential building located at 1792 Block 71, Block 4.01, zoning district R-5A, in the development area of state. And before going further, I'd like to give a small order of business about what happened tonight. We're going to do the application review and then potential.
I just wanted to let the record reflect the meaning for the question. I am fully of what you mean,
certainly, we did the question to the captain that in fact the case, and the council or Jackson County present, we wish to take objection on the record. We wish the public to consider objection on the record, certainly recommend that for the squad.
Will the board have any questions, Mr. Captain?
I guess, members of the board, Thomas F. Kelso, on behalf of the applicant, Construction Management Associates, did have an opportunity to speak to the council about this issue. Again, do you recognize that there have been references to Western University in this application process? We recognize that the regular board council, Mr. Beeson, has accused himself as a result of the ethics complaint having been filed against him. Surrounding his participation in the board as a complaint by Western University. However, it's my client's position in arguing Rutgers University has nothing to do with this application. It's always been our position. We don't believe that anyone with affiliation with Rutgers has any direct or indirect conflict with respect to this application simply because of their employment at the university. Indicated by your counsel, the property is owned by the Brunswick Corporation. My client is a contract purchaser of that property. The fact that there are properties that surround this site that the Rutgers University owns shouldn't be very surprising considering that this application is in the heart of the campus. On that basis, we have no objection to the council participating. As I said, once again, there is no conflict of interest with all the working terms.
Madam Chair, Peter Gardner, on behalf of represent four clients. You know what I can do? I can go up here.
There's another mic.
Is this mic on?
No, right there. Hello? Okay.
For the record, Peter McGarvey from Ace Rankin Associates, as far as I represent the interests of Jennifer O'Neill, Alejandro McMillan, who lives 15 Bond Street. I also represent John Mills and David Drinkwater, who live in a store at 13 Bond Street. And with all due respect, I wanted to point out to counsel as well as the board a Supreme Court case which I was planning on getting in more detail with a little bit later on because I have some comments about Mr. Fulke, as I discussed with your counsel. I believe the case that applies here is a Supreme Court case of Wisconsin versus Jesus. And that is spelled W-Y-Z-Y-K-O-W-S-K-I versus Jesus, R-I-Z-A-S, 132 New Jersey, 509. And what that case talks about, ladies and gentlemen, is the there's four types of situations that our Supreme Court requires disqualification. One is a direct pecuniary interest where an official goes on a matter benefiting the official's own property or according to that financial interest. Second one is the indirect pecuniary interest when an official votes on a matter of financial benefits one closely tied to the official, such as an employer or family. Thirdly, the direct personal interest, when an official votes on a matter that benefits a more relevant or strength in a non-financial way, when that matter is of importance, as the case, for example, the counseling's mother being a nurse or something. Example would be in that case. And finally, the indirect personal interest, when an official votes on a matter which an individual judge may be affected because of membership in some organization. And the desire to help that organization to make policy. I believe that case applies here in every respect. I agree that there is a conflict of interest under this case because the board member is employed by the representatives. There is seminary housing. Will be part of this, and we're going to discuss it. If person who's responsible for the matter of record. Once again, I don't disagree with anything
by my client dated August 8th, 2014, from the state of New Jersey, Department of Environmental Protection, and from the Scale of Resource Preservation, which reads as follows. Dear Mr. Mills, I'm going to be asked to put that in the text to read the letter. This was discussed with council this morning. Council for the board, council signed an email indicating I was going to be making this objection.
Mr. McArthur, I was aware that you could make an objection to the people who were objecting. I was not aware that there was a letter that you could receive. Maybe you have a copy to the letter, and you want to give that a copy to the board and a copy to the council, that would be a copy.
Well, I don't have to read the record. But however, I will tell you that in summary, what it says is that this thing, this property,
based on that, I think here, you have the opportunity for
Madam Chair, I'll be happy to do that. It's been jurisdictional. This property has been certified as eligible for inclusion in the state historic register. There are a number of properties along my street that are included in this designation. I respectfully state that the hearing to the state and final termination by the state is acceptable. Can you respond? Property is privately owned. And whether or not a property is eligible for the state historic register is irrelevant to the property owner if not used for that place. So, under these circumstances, obviously the owner is under a contract to sell to my client, a contract purchaser. No intent to the property. Assuming it is eligible, whether the letter says it is or not, is potentially eligible. The benefit is not attractive to the owner to the property. My understanding, Madam Chair, is that it is not a question of whether or not the owner consents to this procedure. The fact is, it's not.
I'm not sure. The fact that the letter was not considered by the board and representation by council, this property is now eligible for consideration by the historical registry, is something the board can consider. And of course, anyone can certainly ask the question council's grasp to find the truth. But certainly, there are procedures the council is aware of in order to get that on the record. It's more than enough. Well, I have a letter that you can look at that says this is in fact the case. I'm not sure it's any. I would also suggest to the board that maybe we should require to make this application. It certainly doesn't appear to be a problem. I mean, you can help us get otherwise.
Well, I can state for a fact it is not the contract purchaser nor what is the owner of the property.
For a formal certification of eligibility for the minor
Vine Street Historic District, located in the city of New Brunswick, Middlesex County, New Jersey. Based on a review of available documentation, it is my opinion that the Vine Street Historic District is eligible to be listed in the New Jersey and National Register of Historic Places. The district contains many examples of 19th century architecture. The majority of the properties are residential. Preliminarily, the period of significance of the district appears to be circa 1760 through 1910. However, additional documentation discovered during the registration process may also be due. The district is significant under Criterion C. Under Criterion C, it is significant in the area of architecture. It includes good examples of Second Empire, Calumny, and Queen Anne, and as a distinguishable entity. The boundaries of the eligible historic district are Mine Street between College Avenue and Gilden Street, West Side 5 through 65 Mine Street, East Side 4 through 70 Mine Street. However, additional documentation discovered during the registration process may alter these boundaries. If you wish to pursue registration, please contact Caroline Scott of my staff at either 609-633-2396 or charles.scott@dep.nj.gov to help expedite our review and response. If additional consultation with the HPO is needed regarding the nomination of this property, please reference the HPO project number 14-2836 in any future calls, emails, or written correspondence. Thank you for your interest in New Jersey's irreplaceable historic resources. If you have any further questions, please contact Andrea Kindy at 609-984-0539 or andrea.kindy@dep.state.nj.us. Sincerely, Daniel B. Saunders, Administrator and Deputy State Historic Preservation Officer.
I'm sorry. For the record, it is August 8th, 2014, Council, and we're not in court. Administrative proceedings generally rule the evidence are relaxed, but I would note for the record that if we were in court, the public record section here says that we have to apply this and we're missing.
Is
the public record exception? Amendment to the zoning district, given the superseded civil provision of the development regulations. included in his further support by the developer's characterization as provisions as additional requirements. That's also exception 5. As such, as an overlay zoning district, the applicant is required to obtain a D variance from the adjustment to the site plan, contemplating use that is not permitted in R5 zoning, which varies property use in the city. And pursuant to NJSA 455B7, the zoning board adjustment is vested with the exclusive authority of Article 2 variances. Thus, the zoning board has this one respect and has exclusive jurisdiction over this application. Moreover, in the attorney, even if the board finds that the R5 zoning requirements were supplemented to the development plan, effectively rezoning this lot to IN-1, Area 2, the Area 2 redevelopment plan does not permit privately owned apartment buildings in Area 2, because all apartment buildings in the IN-1 zone must be university owned apartment and class 1 buildings. And that's another segment of my citation, which I haven't heard. Parenthetically, if there was a reason, nothing in the redevelopment housing law that supersedes the final rule. This property in question is RA5, if it was rezoned, it's now IN1 of Area 2. And section 62.1 of the MOU law states that those have to be given as classification of the zone or change in zone. And that wasn't done. So I would like to be ruling on this issue from the committee. Chair would like to have the motion on it. Very well. In this matter, we know that Delta, New Jersey, the Brunswick Development Corporation, formed a subsidiary on College Avenue and Valley Associates, and those developers were assigned to construction management associates to I previously set forth the holding of the Wisconsin versus Jesus case in the prior comments. I will not repeat them. They are applicable clearly to Mr. Duke's situation. Now, in light of some recent developments regarding we decided to do our own business. And we found, I think it's general knowledge that Mr. Brunswick is the head coach of the Women's Tennis Club. And back in the early part of this year, they accepted special donations from Chris Pellegrino of New Jersey, the Bronson Development Corporation. This was found on Rutgers Women's website entitled Rutgers Post 27th Annual Tennis Club. And then back on January 27th, the donation was made while the application of the board was pending. This creates the appearance of indirect community of interest. And so the Rutgers Tennis Club program received the financial benefit from the fact that Mr. Oka has accused himself is not enough perspective. It is our position that under the Supreme Court case law, which I discussed specifically with the council this morning, that this board has been irretrievably tainted by his continued representation of this court after this took place. I would also note that if you look at Mr. Brinkley's Facebook page, it reveals that he was granted this type of not liked together. That's additional consideration. Now, the Supreme Court case that I'm talking about, which supports my proposition, is known as Queen Properties versus the City of Hoboken. That's 214 New Jersey 109, 2018 case. Basically, in that case, a developer, by whose variance approval, objector was represented by an attorney by the name of After the approval, but before the appeal was taken by the objector, Mr. Cadis became the attorney for Hilda. He recused himself from the hearings in front of the city council. What happened was that the objector had appealed the zoning board's action to the city council, which is ordinance, which is in place for the appeal. So even he recused himself from those hearings, but he did issue a procedural memo and for their physical result, he not contested. The council then overturned the zoning board adjustment in favor of the applicant. The trial court affirmed the council, but the appellate division said that Hayes tainted the action by the council and remanded to the council for another hearing. Now, at that point, an appeal was taken to the Supreme Court of the state, and the standards that they were drafting in that hearing, because what they were doing is they were asking the Supreme Court to do something known as recommendation of jurisdiction. In other words, we want to use the Supreme Court to hear this matter and make it not trust them down the over. And the standards that this case indicates, the determination is, in the mind of a reasonable citizen, citizens sitting out there in the audience, they're fairly acquainted with the facts. But this scenario create an appearance of impropriety, improper influence, or would cause them to have doubts about the impartiality of the community. This standard remains applicable to municipal officials acting in case of the capacity, clearly appear. The reason for this standard is so that the public does not lack confidence in the integrity of the process and its outcome. And what the Supreme Court held is that his attorney's incomplete refusal irretrievably changed the action taken by counsel. And what they did was, they didn't take original jurisdiction, but they said, the taint is so bad, we don't want this to come back from counsel, the ultimate. So we want this to go to the trial court, and he asked different on the verdict case originally, for a full hearing and supplement the rest of the counsel. Here, that attorney didn't take part in the proceedings that took place. Here, the donation took place early in the evening, and there were at least two hearings that took place after that. My clients had told me when I first got involved in this that, the fault that Mr. Booker, not Mr. Ford, Mr. Booker was citing the applicant. After reviewing some of the record, I have to agree that. That's not what you have to prove. He was making procedural and substantive determinations here. His actions were clearly not ministerial in any sense. My first appearance was here in May, he wanted people to leave the council chamber so he got to have a hearing. There was another excerpt in March before my involvement in which there was an issue regarding the applicant's plan was finishing up the testing. And it was finished, Mr. Hansen said it was finished. And then after that, Mr. Booker asked Mr. Hughes questions as if he was interested. In fact, he said, okay, and so what do you say if the use being consistent with the result? The density being consistent with the result. That this project promotes general welfare, the city of Brunswick, means yes, over. And that would be a special reason to support the application in addition to the answer to the same question, means correct, over, okay, yes. So, with all due respect, I think there's been a new treatment that we, he's worse than what the Supreme Court saw in 25 years. There's a change here, I think, is worthy to be constitutional, again, respectfully. In case we can start over again, don't be getting to know. Thank you.
How would you really
comment? Madam Chair, if you can perhaps go through the three objections, tell me if there are any other objections.
That's it.
Madam Chair,
Thank you, members of the board. I'll be as quick as I can. I do believe that it would be inappropriate to speak in the hearing. I do want to thank you, specifically Mr. Kaplan, and Mr. Duca for stepping aside. I think that was the right thing to do. But I do believe that there are several other conflicts of interest at work here that would jeopardize the right that we all have as citizens to be fair and impartial and unbiased fact-finding. Under the 14th Amendment, you are required to exercise procedural due process. And as I said, since you're working on behalf of the state, there's a requirement that you must be impartial and biased. And I would suggest that Mr. Buka and Mr. Kaplan stepping aside is the correct thing, but it is not enough. And it is not resolve all of the problems. So first, I believe that this board is operating in a way that it has not been adequately constituted according to the law. Specifically, on the New Brunswick City website, it says RS 40:56A-1 that the Environmental Commission must have one member in common with the planning board. And I know that that's been a situation that has not been effectively resolved yet. I believe there may be one member who is perhaps technically in common, but for the record, I don't believe that, Ms. Mugella has attended the Environmental Commission meeting, and I believe that the spirit of the law, the purpose of the law is so that there would be one member in common so that that person, that individual, would report what was going on at the planning board to the Environmental Commission and vice versa. And I think that that element is effectively missing in this case, and would constitute a reason that, again, the board is not adequately constituted, has to be reconstituted. I also understand that at least one member of the board is involved in an organization where Mr. Kelso is in the leadership of the organization. And I am referring to you, Madam Chair. I know that you are an elected Democratic committee woman from your neighborhood, and being a part of that organization means that you work under Mr. Tom Kelso, who is the executive director of that board and appears on that website as the executive director of the committee. And I believe that that represents a conflict that it also means that we should not move forward today. And I do also want to raise that, while I have great respect for Mr. Ethel, the new attorney you have, I do believe that his employment also represents a conflict. My understanding, and I trust he'll correct me if I'm inaccurate, that he works for a law firm where the state senator, Bob Smith, is one of the partners. Mr. Smith, being a Democrat, relies upon officials like Mr. Kelso to help him win office, win the election. And the Democrat Party has supported him wholeheartedly for over a decade. And respectfully, I believe that that direct political connection between the applicant, the person representing the applicant, and the person who is the employer of your attorney represents a conflict that also should prevent this application from moving forward tonight. I do respect this board, and the last thing I would want would be for this to have to get tied up in court. I think that you'd be better off either voting against the project or forcing a new application, or at least voting to table it and reschedule after some of these issues can be addressed and the board can be adequately constituted to such as to comply with that law and some of the conflicts to do with that. That is the extent of my opinion.
Bruce Newling, N-E-W-L-I-N-G. I would like to take this opportunity to have a sense. Oh, one procedural matter here. Is it possible to turn on the microphone so that we can hear very clearly? They're on?
They're on.
Those are on?
Yes.
Oh.
Well, you do not mean.
I just didn't hear the character of the two faces outside. But I can be heard outside.